Okay, well, first of all, good to see you again.
Hey, it's good to see you.
How are you?
Very good.
And pleased about the work you did in the election. I think you made a huge difference. And you'd be done more damage to the left than the FBI has done for many, many years, that's for sure. But what we're here to talk about, James, today is obviously you've got the Trump inauguration coming up. Mm-hmm. And we've never seen such a violent election campaign as we have as this recent one for many, many decades.
Right.
Not since the 60s, probably. So I want to talk about that. I want to talk about the plans for the inauguration, mm-hmm. but also what may happen after, what the left plans to do. Mm-hmm. And when I say the left, I'm talking anything from the Democratic National Committee right down to the street level radicals, the agitators and Marxists mm-hmm. and anarchists that you confront on a daily basis. And during the election, you found extensive ties between leadership, people connected to the leadership of the Democratic National Committee and people actually out there plotting violence against Trump supporters. Can you give us some details about what you found and how extensive that was?
Yeah, we had eight people. We do undercover journalism, so we had eight full-time undercover journalists over the course of about a year who kind of embedded themselves and ingratiated themselves inside the Hillary Clinton campaign. And what we found was this nexus of activity where these operatives would tell us how they would hire mentally ill people to go out and disrupt these protests, these Trump people. They would go into these protests and they would try to induce violence, get a response. And if you watch these videos we produced, it's disturbing. The candor and the degree to which they bragged about doing this. This guy's name was Scott Fovell. He worked for a nonprofit organization in Wisconsin, and he says, quote, the Clinton campaign pays the DNC, the DNC pays this group Democracy Partners, which is a consulting firm, and Democracy Partners pays the Fovell group, this is Scott Fovell, this individual, and they go out and they execute the expletive on the ground. So he describes how the money went from the Hillary campaign through the DNC, through a subcontractor to commit the inducement of violence. And while they're saying this, it's a violation of FEC law, it's immoral, it's probably in some cases illegal. We filed an FEC complaint against the Clinton campaign. And this guy at the top, Bob Creamer was his name, an old friend of Barack Obama, community organizer. Yep. This guy at the top was involved in all of it. In fact, he went to the White House some 300 times, met with the president 47 times, and he was forced to resign his post as connected to the Clinton campaign as a result of these videos.
Yeah, well, I know Bob Creamer. He was involved in the New American Movement back in the 70s, which was a Marxist group that became Democratic Socialists of America. And he's married to Jan Schakowsky, the Chicago congresswoman, who has been a card-carrying member of Democratic Socialists of America, and both have served on the board of the Midwest Academy mm-hmm. out of Chicago, which is an Alinsky community organizing school. So the fact that Creamer is heavily involved as a linchpin between the radical left and the DNC is pretty revealing, I think.
Yes.
And so how you uncovered the Fovell operation. Do you think there are other similar operations going?
Absolutely. In fact, right now, when this interview airs, you will have already seen some tapes that we have coming out inside of groups like Disrupt J20 and other groups across the United States. Some of our journalists have built relationships with some of these people, and we're not going to burn those relationships right now, because it would jeopardize our ability to get more. But we do have some people. I think you guys went into one of these J20 groups where we have people who are inside the boot camp, which was the planning session for the inauguration on the 14th and 15th of January, and exposing all the different techniques and tactics. Some of these things are blatantly illegal, and some of them are violent. Most of them are just illegal. And what I'm interested in is who's pulling the strings at the top. Right. And who's funding it. So Van Jones is one name that was thrown out to us. Soros was openly talked about in some of our meetings. All the money goes through these, you know, blind trusts so that it can't be traced back. So the only way we can prove the connection is in face-to-face meeting, human intelligence gathering. Yep. Face-to-face meetings where they say, well, Soros is behind this group and this group is connected to this group. And that's exactly what Fogel said. You know, he said, quote, the Clinton campaign pays the DNC, DNC pays Democracy Partners, and Democracy Partners pays me. So this is our goal, is to catch this type of activity.
Yeah, I think Mike Lax is involved in Democracy Partners.
He was the one who we ran into him. It was Mike Lux, Brad Woodhouse, Mike Lux, Bob Kramer, and Scott Fogel were the four.
Yeah. Well, Mike Lax was also a member of Democratic Socialists of America. Mm-hmm. When he was an activist in Iowa in the 90s. So that ties this Marxist group. You've got Kramer and Lux both involved with this Marxist group, liaising between the radicals on the ground and the DNC. Mm-hmm. Now, do you think the DNC is actively still involved in helping any of these groups or coordinating any of these groups?
Well, interestingly enough, I actually ran into Donald Brazil, strangely, at a conference, a hotel elevator 2 months ago in November, and it was a surprising encounter. When I first saw her, I thought, let me get my camera out, let me like try to ambush her or something, you know, because she's obviously hostile to me. She went on Megyn Kelly's show and she said I'm a criminal and all these things. And she said, no, James, I want to talk to you. She said, I want to talk to you. And I said, this is odd. She's either trying to bait me or she's going to betray her side to give me information. I think it was she was just trying to bait me because she did say she was going to follow up with information. Donna Brazil confided in me that she and Wasserman Schultz were not getting along and there was some disarray, but she never emailed me. So I think what Donna Brazil was trying to do was get me to admit I did something illegal. She did say to me she swept her offices for bugs, you know, like as if we put a listening device and left it there. We never do that. At Veritas, we always have the camera on the person
right.
to make sure it's legal. But Donna Brazil was trying to bait and probably find out if I had actually put bugs down. I think the DNC is in a state of a little restructuring right now and trying to find their vision and their objectives. I think the real targets, subjects that need to be exposed are the money people who are funding all of these groups that are sowing discord.
And who do you mentioned Van Jones. So these are people mentioning these names in context, you know, through his Color of Change
right.
or whatever organization. So money is trickling down from higher
yes.
up into these radical organizations
yes.
so they can distance themselves from these bomb threat, well, from these, you know, street agitators.
Yeah, and in the case of Democracy Partners, it was as simple as what did Hillary know and when did she know it? And if you look at these videos, I mean, Bob Kramer is no low level guy. He is friends with Obama.
Yeah.
Mm. He's met with Obama, according to White House logs, 47 times. Mm. It is a matter of public record. It's not my video. It's on the White House log.
Yeah.
And Bob Kramer says in the third installment of these series we did, he says, it was Hillary's idea to put ducks on the ground. Ducks meaning dressing up like Donald Duck and getting punched in the face, you know, inciting this type of thing. He said it was Hillary's idea. That's his testimony, Bob Kramer. So that's something else. So Trump brought it up in the debate with Hillary. He said, you caused the violence on the video. You did it. And she never denied it.
No, she couldn't.
She couldn't deny it. She, when she was on the airplane and she was asked by the Fox News correspondent, she actually said, let's go get food. She changed the subject and walked away. I found that very interesting. So what about this case? What about right? What's happening right now? I think the answer is, you know, Michael Moore is tweeting about it. You know, some of the people that we interview are saying Van Jones is behind it. Some people are saying Soros is connected. The question for if you're a journalist is, the people on the ground are going to do a lot of crazy activity, but who is directing them and what do they know about? That's what interests me, and that's what our investigation coming out this week, the week of the inauguration, is answering.
Exactly. So, okay, so you've had people inside. There are several organizations organizing to disrupt leading up to the inauguration, disrupt J20.
Yes.
Most of them have J20 in their name.
Yes.
Some of them are affiliated with the Workers' World Party, which is pro-North Korean Iran. Some are affiliated with the Freedom Road Socialist Organization, the Revolutionary Communist Party. How much coordination do you think is going on between these groups?
That's something, you know, and at the time of this interview, which is, Wednesday? A week before we release these stories, we're still trying to answer honestly and accurately and thoroughly your question. Mm-hmm. But in some cases, the left hand, John Fun likes to say, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing when it comes to a group like Acorn. Mm-hmm. I find there's a lot of coordination between Disrupt J20 and some of the other groups. In fact, one of the ladies that worked for Bob Cramer is intimately involved with Disrupt J20. So I think a lot, and we found Lauren Windsor was her name. So we're finding a lot of overlap. We have a whole diagram here in our office where, as we're currently investigating, we're trying to tie these things together. The question is, does the left hand know what the right hand is doing? And that is something that we have to investigate and expose, is what do they know about? But I find that this is a very small cabal of leaders in Washington, D.C. right now. We attended the same meeting you did, and at the Episcopal Church. And one of our people actually got burned because she was speaking with Lauren Windsor, who she met during the Democracy Partners investigation. So it's very closely right. aligned.
So this is the big argument, isn't it? The media will tell, the mainstream media will tell you that this is spontaneous, this is upset and angry Americans lashing out at a government they distrust, they are fearful of.
Right.
So what have you found that would contradict that narrative?
I mean, are they genuine? Are they sincere? I mean, these are definitely fringe people. I mean, you see it in our tapes. I mean, one of them is talking about committing acts of maybe even terrorism. It's very fringe. We have to be very careful. We never break the law, so we would never suggest violence. So it's even hard for us to bring it up in conversation because we would never want to endorse or suggest violence. But we overheard things in these meetings. We overheard them talking about trying to disrupt a train on the railroad tracks, setting down chains. I mean, definitely immoral, illegal, maybe even terroristic activities. I can't even ask about it because I would never want to be seen as conspiring with these folks. But to answer your question, is it? I think there are definitely some people who care about their country, and there's nothing illegal about protesting. There's nothing illegal about getting involved.
But what I'm getting at here is the media tells us this is widespread and spontaneous, but you seem to find that this is really organized by a small. This is not spontaneous eruptions in various cities. You found that this is very well coordinated. That this is a small cabal of people who are really running things from centrally.
We're just learning. We're not finished with our investigations this week and next week, and we've got people who are embedded and they're going to stay embedded for a long, long time to understand the extent of this. But if Democracy Partners is any indication, that came right from Cramer, and Cramer met with Obama, and it came right from Hillary Clinton. It doesn't get any bigger than that. It doesn't get any higher than that. But I think the key names are George Soros, Tom Steyer, maybe Van Jones, maybe people like Michael Moore. And let's find out the other 20 individuals who know about the activities on the ground, who understand that's what their goals and objectives are, and who are funding them.
Sure. So obviously there's a lot of money involved here because these people are busing people from all over the country. There are events planned in every area. So how extreme do you think this could get? How violent do you think some of these people could be?
I hope not, because Veritas is, again, it's now January the 11th. I hope we release our stories and it deters that from happening. I hope when this airs, you'll see. But my hope is that by exposing the activity, we have their blueprints. We found their everywhere they're going to be, all the roads they're going to disrupt, all their plans. They're going to try to intervene on these balls that are happening. So my hope is by being transparent about what their plans are, that either deters them from doing these unethical, immoral things. What I don't want to do is deter, good people who just want to make their voices heard. But I do want to stop any illegal activity. And I want to make sure the American people know who's behind it.
So you've actually heard people discussing putting chains on train
yes.
tracks.
Yes.
Which could cause a derailment.
Yes, but we have to alert law enforcement about that. Absolutely. That's something we have to do immediately.
So this is actually potentially putting people's lives at risk.
And my hope is that will not happen because of the work that Veritas has done to uncover this. Yes.
But I think it makes the point. Americans have to understand these are not just ordinary liberals or Democrats who are just disgruntled. These are actually very extreme, very, very fanatical people in some cases who are actually starting a movement that they want to really, they really want to cause disruption.
I'll tell you what, one of the videos that you either have seen come out when this interview airs or may come out in the next day or two is one of our journalists actually was compromised and was sitting there, and she did nothing illegal, but they realized that this is a journalist for Project Veritas. They chased her down the street for 20 minutes, screaming obscenities at her, saying things that I can't even say in a camera to a woman. She got into a cab. They got into the cab with her and berated her, verbally assaulted her. It was almost demented to watch. Sick, twisted things they were doing to a woman. Now people say, James, you go undercover. Yeah, I go undercover. I don't ever berate people that way. Our method is questioning. Our method is relationship building, which is fine. But the way they conducted themselves, I am going to go to DC, and I am going to put a camera in their face and say, what is wrong with you? How could you talk to someone like... I mean, it's clearly we got under their skin, clearly, for them to behave that way. But nothing should ever... I mean, you could see the soul. By the way, they haven't released this tape. They filmed this. They were filming us, and had the recorder device on. They didn't release this portion of the tape, and I have this tape, and I will release this tape next week, and I'm going to confront Clayton is his name, and I'm going to ask him, like, what is wrong with you? What gives you the right to talk to people? But this is the way these people are wired. I've always said that there is a kind of ends justify the means. They're Machiavellian. They'll do whatever it takes to win, and they don't have any belief in law or justice or right and wrong. There's no line.
Yeah. So would you say it's fair to say that, most Americans look at the protesters and they say, well, they have a right to protest, and we all agree with that. But when they start talking about illegal activities, harassing people, invading property, yeah. violating property rights, do they actually operate on a different ethical system than most Americans would consider proper?
Yeah, there was a book by Saul Alinsky. It's in our conference room here, it's Rules for Radicals is actually framed. People say, well, James, are you an Alinskyite? No, I'm not. I wouldn't characterize myself as an Alinskyite. However, there's a lot we can learn from Alinsky that is not immoral. Alinsky was a tactician. Alinsky yeah. talked about organizing and exposing hypocrisy and making your adversary live up to their own principles. These are not unchristian principles. These are just principles that anyone who's a political organizer should follow. But there was also a darker side. There was a book by Joe Fletcher called Situational Ethics.
Yeah.
And in this book, if you want to get wax a little philosophical, it's do the ends justify the means is too broad. They think, well, do the ends justify the means in this particular case? So there's a sort of situational ethics as it relates to what you want to accomplish. And what I've learned in my career, and I've been doing this for 8 years, I've been through a lot. I've been arrested and targeted, and my government has accused me of things I have not done. Is these people don't believe in a right and wrong. They don't believe They don't believe in a rule of law. They don't believe in the Constitution. They believe in winning. That's it. That's it. And there are things that you and I will not do. If I'm undercover, I'm never going to go in someone's private bedroom. I'm never going to, you know, establish physical contact with that person. There's lines I will not cross in the course of doing what I do. These people don't believe in there being a line. They don't think the way that you and I think. And my objective is not to tell you this, it's to show you this.
Yeah.
It's to show people how these people behave so that you can make up, you can, you know, figure that out for yourself.
So we've had a whole election cycle with a lot of violence. We could have a very fraught inauguration. You know, they will try and shut it down. They will try and create chaos. But we've heard in some of these meetings that these people want to carry this on for 4 years through the entire course of the Trump administration. Mm-hmm. So is an infrastructure being set up here that can carry on this protest and disruption right through the term of a Trump presidency? Have you seen evidence of that?
See, it's hard for me. If I give too much away, I burn my journalists. But I am seeing the very beginnings. Remember, they're just still in the planning stage. I don't even think that, you know, I don't think Trump has determined exactly what his vision is over the next 4 years. We're not even at the inauguration yet. We're not within the 100 first days. So I think these people are planning. But I think the inauguration, it's going to be very fascinating to see to what extent this protest movement happens and what extent it's covered by the mainstream media. With a March for Life, it happens in D.C., and what? We see page A36 that there are some people assembled in Washington.
Thousands of people.
A couple hundred people. And then there's like 17 cameras at the steps of the Supreme Court where there's like seven, you know, pro-choice protesters. So what extent will be covered by the mainstream media is the first question. And the second thing is, I don't think you could possibly answer that yet. They're in the stages of raising the money, figuring out who their, is it Keith Ellison, the guy running the DNC?
Yep.
They're figuring out who's their leadership. And we can't possibly answer that yet. The best we can do at Veritas is to ingratiate ourselves, build relationships with these folks, and learn their plans over the next 100 days.
Have you found any evidence at all, or seen any evidence of any foreign involvement in any of this?
Well, in our own work, to a limited degree, I've read and I've talked to sources. One of the guys I think you know about, Maurice Strong, in Canada. We've always tried to determine if the motivations behind these people were pure, whether they had America's best interest at heart, or whether they had investments overseas that, for example, changed their perspective. Now, you've done a lot of work in the environmental area. So we did an investigation 3 years ago where we caught environmental filmmakers in Hollywood meeting with Arab oil tycoons because the Arab oil money wanted to stop American energy independence,
exactly,
so they could export more oil or fracking derivatives to the United States.
Yeah.
So again, that's one example. Energy, there's a guy who's Scott Pruitt, is going to head up the EPA. I always like to expose, like Alinsky does, the source of their hypocrisy. Oh, well, we're against fracking. Well, that's interesting, considering you take oil money from overseas.
Yes.
Right?
Well, there's a lot of evidence that the Russian government has been funding the anti-fracking movement in Europe and here, for instance, because obviously Europe depends on Russian oil and they don't want to stop that. We have found in our investigations that some of the leading agitators in this movement have ties to both Russia and Iran. And I'm talking right now, you know, right in the last few months, few weeks. Have you found any evidence of you know, because there are several communist groups involved in this. You know, there's Workers' World Party, Freedom Road Socialist Organization, Revolutionary Communist Party, there's Communist Party USA, Democratic Socialists of America, etc., many of whom are basically allied to the North Korean government, Iranian government, the communist movement in Russia and China.
Mm-hmm.
Have you found any obvious communist influence in these movements?
Not yet. It hasn't been our focus. I can tell you a lot of the characters we are interacting with in J20 are pretty far out there, and we may expand our scope of focus. But in the Democracy Partners investigation, interestingly enough, we talked to Brad Woodhouse. You mentioned Brad Lux, Brad Woodhouse.
Yeah, Mike Lux.
Mike Lux. Yeah. Mike Lux and Brad Woodhouse. Brad Woodhouse runs Americans United for Change, which is a non-for-profit organization. By the way, that guy denied everything we exposed. Just went on Fox and called me a convicted criminal and a liar, and it was interesting to watch. Brad Woodhouse took $20,000 from an offshore shell company that we created, offshore company, and we'd wired him money from an overseas account. And he met with a British fund manager to him and Bob Creamer met with this guy, took the money. And then as soon as we released the story, they sent the money right back to us. But they never batted an eye. They never expressed concern about the source of the funds. Mm. So in order to expose the foreign involvement, we have to reverse engineer it. And we have to pose as a foreign involvement like we did in the fracking investigation. And we were pretty effective at we caught Ed Begley Jr., who's on the board of the Oscars, and Josh Tickell, who produced a movie called Fuel. And they were telling us, oh, by the way, Mariel Hemingway, the granddaughter of Ernest Hemingway, they were telling us, don't tell anybody where the money comes from. Don't reveal the source of the money. And then when they produced that movie, Promised Land, it actually said Abu Dhabi was the source of the money. It said it in the credits. It was in plain view, but hidden, you know, in plain view, because very few people have actually talked about it.
It's interesting because, we've found this extensive, the work like in, there is extensive influence by the Workers' World Party, for instance, in this movement, a lot of influence by the Freedom Road Socialist Organization, all which are, you know, some of these people have been arrested for terrorism offences in the past. Joe Yosbacher out of Chicago has been heavily involved. He advised the students who shut down the Trump rally in Chicago in March. That guy had been in Moscow in 2014 and 2015 and was arrested for terrorism offences, suspected terrorism offences back in 2010. Mm-hmm. So there's some pretty heavy characters involved here.
Yeah.
And everything we have looked at indicates that they intend to carry this on right through. They intend to make slow the Trump administration down as much as they possibly can, and to make the country ungovernable where they can.
Sure.
One of the groups, the Freedom Road Socialist Organization, they are making some of their people into ordained ministers so they can set up churches that provide sanctuary for illegal immigrants. So these are communists becoming certified ministers so they can provide sanctuary to basically, to stop Trump's agenda of repatriating illegal immigrants.
Yeah.
So they're pretty deep and pretty organized, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But finding out the money, where the money comes from, would be absolutely huge in this.
That's the most important thing. Follow the money, as they say, if you're an investigative journalist, and making it transparent. And one of the things about Veritas, which makes us very different from other organizations, and is that, you know, we believe that the exposing the way things really work and how people behave and catching on video, the truth becomes kind of self-evident. The public policy solutions become self-evident. Fox News says we report, you decide. I think that simplifies it a little bit, but we expose the reality of how things work and what the motivations are. We take money from overseas Arab people, or we want to put chains on the railroad tracks, and oh, by the way, we're working with this guy. And I think the Americans look at that and they say, I don't want to live in that world. Or as Breitbart would say, e pluribus unum, you know, we're not meant to sow discord and hate and division and racial disunity. I think when you show people the truth, people are able to come to a conclusion about the type of world they want to live in. And it's not possible without video. It's not possible unless you can show people, they can hear, and they can really understand how these people behave. Because the truth is, you have a right to believe in these kooky, crazy ideologies, although ideologies can have killed people throughout the 20th century. But it needs to be exposed. You need to see and hear what these people are doing. And we're doing the best we can. It's dangerous, by the way. These people are dangerous. And our people at Veritas are risking, you know, it's not no longer even me, it's my team. It's not just me, I'm a team. They're risking their lives to do this, to go undercover with these crazy people who may, you know, be ready to ambush them.
Yeah. Well, as you've seen, you know, they chased one of your people down a street in broad daylight and harassed her and gave her a very, very hard time. Maybe had that happened in a darkened street in a non-public area, maybe it could have been even worse.
Oh yeah, they got and you'll see this footage come out. They got into a cab with her. They were screaming at her. They were saying sexual things to her. They have one. There's one standard that exists for them. If I ever did that, by the way, if I ever behaved in that manner, you and I wouldn't be having this conversation. I would lose all respect from my audience, from the people in my life, from the media itself. This is just something that Andrew Breitbart taught me years ago. He said they're going to hold you to a different standard. Or how about that video that they did where they beat up the person with special needs and they took a knife to him and they couldn't admit that it was a hate crime. If that is not a hate crime, what is a hate crime? What would qualify? Is it possible for them to commit hate crimes? So again, it goes back to law, it goes back to the definition of justice, and they don't think that they can be that they can commit acts of injustice because it's their Machiavellian. It's all related.
Yeah, because to the radicals, they are doing God's work.
Yes.
So whatever they do by definition is right, and whatever we do to oppose them by definition is completely wrong. So it's you know, we admire those who lied and cheated and disrupted the Nazis during World War II because they were clearly on the side of right.
Or Whitaker Chambers in Witness, how he talks about first chapter Witness, how he talks about in his letter to my children how the communist belief in God, I'm sorry, the communist belief in social change surpasses the Christian's belief in God.
Yeah.
I've certainly found that true in my own dealings with both the conservative movement in America and the left, is that, you know, there are very few people in this country, there are people, but there are few of them who have both courage and integrity. There are many people with integrity and not much courage, right? Mm. And then there are many people with courage but not much integrity. And you see these agitators have a ton of, I hate to call it courage, but a ton of nerve with no integrity whatsoever. And you have a lot of good, decent people in this country who are afraid to stand up for their principles because of the retaliation from the IRS, from the Obama DOJ. I'll tell you a story here on this Democracy Partners investigation. I can't tell you the name of the company, but we had these videos, by the way, got some 30 million views on Twitter and Facebook, some 50 million views on YouTube. These videos were a phenomenon. And did you know that we took these videos to some major media institutions who were willing to talk to me and willing to produce the stories, and they spiked the stories at the last minute for fear of retaliation from a future Clinton FCC.
Yeah, yeah.
They were afraid, not because the stories were false, the stories were very true, and they even spoke to Creamer, but they were afraid of retaliation against them by the government for telling the truth. So where do you go?
Yeah.
What do you do? Well, we went to Facebook and Twitter, but then Twitter wants to ban you.
Mm.
And then Facebook wants to, now you're fake news.
Yeah.
And this is interesting. This is what we're the real issue here.
Well, we've had exactly the same experience with our movie. You know, we've had very mainstream media who turned us down at the last moment. And we know this because they feared intimidation. They feared what would happen if Hillary Clinton became president. What forces of the state could come down on their head. And so So if you look at what you do, James, you know, you're right. You know, Facebook wants to ban what they call false news. Mm-hmm. Twitter is clearly controlled by the left, is banning people. And people are feared to have, up until now, been feared to afraid to come forward because of possible retaliation from an Obama or in the Clinton administration. Mm-hmm. So where would we be without guys like you?
Well, it's, again, I used to be just me and, you know, my dad's garage, and now, as you can see, visiting our location here, we have some 30 people and then some. But I think the real issue, this is important, and this is a component. I think the real issue, what it really comes down to, the analogy I would draw is, it's kind of like the abortion issue. It's like, when does life begin? That's really, people create straw men, but the real issue is, when does life begin? I tend to believe it begins at conception. But in the case of journalism, the question is, who is and who is not a journalist? That is the defining question of our time. Because people like you and me, who go out and expose this stuff, we're shifting the what they call the Overton window, which is the sociological effect of you can talk about things that the mainstream won't talk about. No one wants to talk about this. It's not kosher to talk about Obama meeting with Creamer, to talk about violence. We're talking about it. We're shifting the public consciousness. So the real issue is, and this is the issue I fight every day of my life, for the last 8 years, is they cannot limit the definition of journalist. Nowadays, everyone is a journalist. In fact, we don't need a shield law. The First Amendment of the Constitution, it's enshrined that every American has the right to do and to conduct journalism. Journalism is not a profession anymore. It is now an activity that is protected by the First Amendment. And this is the battle of our time. This is the battle that's happening right now. Because if they can arbitrarily decide who is qualified, credentialed, if they can make that decision for us, then we're gonna lose.
Well, if they can decide who's a journalist, they can decide who's not a journalist, mm-hmm. and who is therefore gonna be disqualified from being a journalist. So that means that they can basically shut down free and open debate. And I think the great thing of our time is, yes, because of cell phones, because of the new media, because of the internet, anybody can be a journalist. And so many stories have been broken with people with cell phones at certain places, with cell cameras. So yeah, we have to keep that wide open. We have to keep it, that mm-hmm. First Amendment, totally protected, because if they can define what is a journalist and what news what news can be published, they've got us.
That's the, in my opinion, that is the only fight. Because what you're going to see is, when you democratize information, like when these things become transparent, these things about communist activity, illegal fundraising, violent activity, the American people, it's not that the American people are stupid, it's that the American people have, in many cases, been uninformed. Because even the people that voted for Barack Obama, if they could hear, if they could see Lois Lerner behind closed doors saying, I want you to target this person, I want you to target that guy. By the way, that's illegal. You can't do that. That's a felony to do what she did. Mm. If they could hear it, if they could see it, you know what they'd say? They'd say, I don't want to live in that world.
Yeah.
I don't want to live in a country where my government targets me because of what I believe. That's unconscionable. It's almost a punch to the gut. So in many ways, what our job is to punch people in the gut. Is to shake the goat, is to wake them up. It's so hard to do because you got to get into all these places with hidden cameras. But I'm telling you, the issue of our time is, what is journalism? Now, now here's the good news. It's not all bad news. The good news is, we're not just fighting, we're winning. We're not just fighting, we are winning. When I was at the Trump night in the Hilton, when he won in New York, I looked across the scene, and there were 500 journalists with their big lights and their cameras, and they were sobbing. They were crying. And they weren't crying just because Trump had won. They were crying because they understood that the power has shifted away from them, that every prediction was wrong, everything they said was wrong, every poll was wrong, everything is wrong, and the people are gravitating away from them, and they're not believing them anymore. and they're just so utterly powerless and irrelevant. And that's the good news.
That's the great news.
We're fighting and we're winning.
Yeah. Now that's fantastic, James, and you're absolutely right. What you have done and what journalists like you have done has shifted the power away from the elites to the people. And that's where we want it to be.
Power, that's where power, in a democratic republic, it has to be with the people, and we have to democratize information, and they do not want that to happen. They do not want that to happen, but we're going to make it happen.
So in your opinion, James, and what you've seen with your tapes, mm-hmm. and your dealings with these radical elements, is there any limit to where they go, where they will go with this?
If they know they can get away with it, the answer is no. They will do whatever they can get away with. They will do whatever the media allows them to get away with. And as we democratize information, and as the people, there's a sort of groundswell effect where most people rise up and say, I can't live in this country where people are, I don't want to live in a world where people behave this way. I think the arrogance and the hubris which we see when we turn on the television and when they see these politicians lie, you're all familiar with it, lie after lie after lie after lie, under oath even. And John, is it Koshinen at the IRS and others like that?
Yeah.
Where they just get in front of the TV, and the hubris and the arrogance, I think, will kind of go away when the American people say, I don't believe you. And that's what Paul Ryan said, by the way, to Koshinen, didn't he? Paul Ryan did say to Koshinen, I don't believe you. And Koshinen responded, well, I have 50 years of government experience and everyone should believe me, right? He's relying on his bona fides as a government, just like CNN says, well, I'm CNN. Or New York Times says, well, I'm a respected, established, verified, credentialed journalist. Who are you going to believe? James O'Keefe or Trevor? Or are you going to believe the New York Times? Well, guess what's happening?
Yeah.
Things are changing. And people are actually saying, you know what? I put a lot more faith in Trevor than I put in CNN. And CNN tweets at me and says, well, James, I got an audience of 1.5 million people. And Steve Gordon at Veritas tweets back, yeah, our YouTube videos have 10 million views in the last 24 hours. 10 million people saw our videos. Only 1.5 million people watched CNN. So the answer to your question is that things are changing. And I think they will not be able to get away with the extremist stuff when the American people wake up.
Exactly. There's one thing I'd like to add, and maybe you could comment on this. I've always believed, you know, we've always had government intelligence services to guard the country against radicals. But what happens if the government is controlled by radicals?
Yeah.
And the intelligence service has to answer to those radicals?
Right.
The country becomes defenseless, right?
Interesting, yeah.
So therefore, you need private intelligence agencies who are not dependent on the government, who are not funded by the government,
yeah,
and who are not beholden to whoever's in power at the time.
Yeah.
Is that a fair concept, do you think?
It's a very fascinating discussion. Maybe a whole day of discussion, and I'd be interested in maybe offline talking about Ed Snowden and getting your thoughts about that. Are you a hero or a traitor? Or is there some are you a hero and a traitor? Is it hard to bifurcate that dichotomy? It's a very interesting, and sort of how they railroaded Eric Prince, who founded Blackwater, who tried to do something, probably a good thing for the military. Whether we want to privatize these things, and by the way, whether or not we should promote transparency within our intelligence agencies, yeah. Or is that compromising our national security?
Well, there's the thing, like, you know, if you look at, say, a guy like, who was Holder, Eric Holder. Now, he wouldn't pass an FBI background check, right? There's no way. You know, he was involved with the Black Panther type people. He was involved in an occupation of a student. He was involved with extreme radicals, communists, etc. There's no way he could pass a background check. Yet he headed the Justice Department, which controlled the FBI.
That's right.
So the chicken is guarding, the fox is guarding the hen house.
Yes.
So if we rely only on government intelligence agencies,
right,
and they are controlled by people of bad character.
Right.
Where does that leave the American people?
That's an excellent, excellent point. And I would add to it, to what extent do we rely upon independent investigative groups like Veritas or anyone else to provide a check and a balance? Because there's no separate, you're talking about the separation of powers. They're just under the Obama administration hasn't been any separation of powers. I mean, Obama, and I mean, I can tell you right now that Kamala Harris, who is a senator from California, spent more time targeting David Dilaiden, who did the pro-life videos, than she did actually doing her job as the Attorney General of California.
Yeah.
So the lack of separation of powers is a huge, it's near and dear to our hearts, that issue. And a lot of people ask me, what do you think about, you know, attempts to expose things happening in the intelligence agencies? I thought it was interesting with James Clapper, who basically did perjure himself under oath and said, we're not spying on the people. Mm. And now the Huffington Post is saying he's a hero for going up against Trump. This is another example of the ends justify the means, that the intelligence agencies, these wonderful people, are testifying that Russia had rigged our election. There's so much hypocrisy. Yeah. I don't even know where to begin.
Well, that's what I think the point is. You make the point, when you get a government that is tyrannical, separation of powers goes out the window. Yeah. So therefore, you cannot rely on your Justice Department, you cannot rely on your intelligence services, and you cannot rely on your law enforcement to be fair and honest. No. So therefore, you need organizations like yourself who are doing that intelligence work, who are exposing corruption, because we didn't have you. We didn't have people like you doing it. Under the Obama years, we would have had nothing.
Tocqueville, one of my favorite philosophers, there's a sign in my foyer here, and he talks about the will of men are gradually broken down until they become eviscerated by a series of laws, by inaction, in a fear. And the American people over the last 8 years, their will has been gradually broken down. Donors don't want to give to nonprofit organizations because they're afraid of being retaliated against.
Don't want to donate to the GOP.
That's
right. Whatever.
And what happens is people become paralyzed by their fear until they're unable to do anything for their republic.
Mm.
And what this has given us, we basically, you know, I hate to put it in religious terms, but I think God has basically given us a second chance.
That's exactly
I don't know whether this is going to go in a positive direction or a neutral direction or what direction it's going to go in, but we were on the precipice. My group would have been targeted beyond anything you could imagine. They would have charged me with things I never planned to do. They would have manufactured evidence and destroyed other evidence, which they've done to me in the past. So I think we've been given a second chance.
Yeah.
And I think people are now have a little hope, and we need to use this as a springboard, this hope, this energy to promote the cause of transparency.
Look, absolutely. I couldn't agree more, because we know when we did our movie, if Hillary Clinton had won, we're going to be in for a world of grief.
Yeah.
You know, we were, you know, but we got to go. But,
yeah.
But you know, that's exactly it. You know, you put your nuts on the line knowing that if the election went the wrong way, you're going to be in for it.
But there's great joy in fighting, too.
I
like being a guerrilla journalist. I just don't like being in jail and having Jim Letton in Louisiana go online and blog about me anonymously. That's another story.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much, James. And we're sorry we're late, but
it was
really good talking to you.
All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Appreciate it. And we'll make sure you get some copies of our DVD.
I would love that.
Thank you.
Great.